welcome back to what we call Pastor Talks here at CCLC. I do this every week to encourage you with the Word of God, just in my personal study. And the reason that I do this is to encourage you to be an encouragement, that the Word of God illuminates the places that are dark. And it's our responsibility to carry that light to the people that need it. So we've been reading through the book of Hebrews together, and we're going to finish the book of Hebrews this morning in Hebrews chapter 13. So if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and open up to Hebrews chapter 13, and we're going to read starting in verse 1. It says, "Let brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember those who are in prison, as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you are also in the body." Now, what you're going to notice about this chapter is that the author concludes his letter by giving them a clear line. And that line represents the difference between those that recognize Jesus and walk in light of the gospel and the world around them. And so he starts here by asking them to be careful to remember the stranger that's in their life, to be kind to the person that is across from them, even if they don't recognize them, because you never know who that person might be. And then in the same way, he's asking them to remember the people that are suffering for their faith. Remember that these people are struggling to hang on to their faith because of the challenges that they're facing. And so in an encouragement to have them hold on to their faith, he's reminding them that there are people that are suffering that haven't let go, to remember those people as if you are with them in prison, because we are all one body connected. So he's going to continue to draw that line here. Keep reading with me in verse 4. It says, "Let marriage be held in high honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled, for God will judge the sexually immoral and the adulterous. Keep your life from the love of money and be content with what you have, for he has said, 'I will never leave you nor forsake you.' So we can confidently say, 'The Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me?'" There's this lifestyle that we've been called to, and he starts by challenging them to honor marriage in a way that the world around them doesn't, to honor the importance of and the sanctity of marriage. When the world is adulterous, when the world is selfish, recognize what God has laid down. And then in the same way, he asks them to see the importance of not loving things or money or things of the world, but being content with the things that they have, recognizing that all the things that they have come from the Father to care for them. And if there's a need, recognize that the Father provides those things. I have no reason to fear because I have my Father. There is peace in that. There is security in that. So he's encouraging them to walk that way. Keep reading with me in verse 7. It says, "Remember your leaders who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be led astray by strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened by grace and not by foods which have not benefited those who devoted to them." There are people in your life that have come alongside you in faith and taught you foundational things. Remember those people and recognize the outcome of their life. Recognize the ways that being dedicated to the word and to the things that are foundational leads to blessing, not just in your own life, but in the lives around you. And then recognize that there are strange and diverse teachings that come from all over the place in regards to God, in regards to salvation, in regards to a lot of different things. Don't be led astray by them. Hold on to what is good, to what you've been taught, and don't be pulled this way or that way by the things that might be taught by other people. Keep reading with me in verse 10. We have an altar from which those who serve the tent have no right to eat. For the bodies of those animals whose blood was brought into the holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Remember that this letter is written to an Israelite demographic, and they would have recognized that sacrifices for sin are done outside of the dwelling place. They're done outside of the camp, and that camp represents the presence of God, and so the sacrifices are done outside of that. And then, as he's done in the entirety of this letter, he ties that foundational, generational, cultural truth that they recognize, and he ties it in with what Jesus has done. In the same way, Jesus also suffered outside the camp. Now, look at the way that he applies this to their life in verse 13. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. Through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of our lips that acknowledge his name. Let us also offer. In the example of Jesus, let us go to him. Let's go outside the camp, and let's praise God for who he is, for what he's done, for the differences between the way that God has called us to live and the way that the world calls us to live. Let's go out there and offer a sacrifice worthy, acknowledging his name and praising him. Keep reading with me in verse 16. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who have to give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you. Pray for us. We are sure that you have a clear conscience, desiring to act honorably in all things. I urge you the more earnestly to do this in order that I may be restored to you the sooner. There are people that act as leaders in the kingdom of God. And there's different kinds of leadership, and there's different places that people are serving. But recognize the people that are leading you. Recognize them and then pray for them, because it is a difficult position to be in. And most of them are being discouraged in one way or another. So pray for them that they would do the work that's set before them joyfully and not begrudgingly. And then he asks them to pray for him because he wants to come and see them as soon as possible. He closes out this letter this way. Now, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. I appeal to you, brothers, bear with my word of exhortation, for I have written to you briefly. You should know that our brother Timothy has been released, with whom I shall see if he comes soon. Greet all your leaders and all the saints, and those who come from Italy, send your greetings. Grace be with all of you. May the God that has done all of these amazing things, that has been so faithful to his people, may he equip you with everything that you need to be who you've been called to be. Hebrews is a challenging letter. It's filled with really deep and challenging theology. But I'm glad that you've been along for the ride. We're going to pick back up next week with our pastor talks in the book of Mark. We're going to read through the book of Mark together. And it's going to side by side with the sermon series that we're going through as a church body. So share that with people. Share the encouragement that you received today with people. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pray over you, and I hope that you have a blessed day. Father, thank you for all that you do, for all that you've done, for all that you are. Help us to be the people, equip us to be the people that you need us to be. It's because of Jesus that this is all possible, and so it's in his name that I pray. Amen.